Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
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 Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Psalm 66 verses 1 and 2 says, make a joyful noise to God all the earth. Sing the glory of His name. Give to Him glorious praise. And yes, why do we do that? Because the Lord has done so many great and wonderful things in our lives. If we look back in our lives, we could see how the Lord has kept us safe and brought us so far. There are so many blessings which we cannot count, but yes, we can remember them and we can acknowledge them and we can offer to Him a word of praise and thanks. So let us recall to our minds all that the Lord has done so far in our lives. Just offer to Him a word of praise and thanks as we sing, how great and mighty is His name. Great and mighty is the Lord our God.
And it is the name above every other name. And before Him,
every knee in heaven, on earth, and under the earth will bow. It is the name of Jesus. Let us call on the mighty, the powerful, the most healing name of Jesus. Let us call on the saving name of Jesus as we sing, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Let us be still before the Lord and tell the Lord, speak, Lord, your servant is listening. For the Lord says in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 11, verses 28, come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end.
Praise the Lord. I am asked to give this talk for you, my dear sisters, who are in retreat. I, in a special way, would like to thank the National Service of Communion of the CCR and also Sister Pauline, who, in a special way, has organized this sisters' retreat. And she requested me at least to give one talk. So here I am. And the topic that is given to me is religious life, a gift and responsibility. Now I would like to invite each one of you. Let's turn to our Blessed Mother, who was a perfect religious, and pray to her so that she may intercede for us, she may help us. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Lord Jesus, we have gathered here to listen to you. It's you who have called us. It's you who have consecrated us. It's you who have enabled us to become partners in the mission that is entrusted to you by the Father. I ask you at this moment, give me a fresh anointing of the Spirit that I may speak your words. I also ask you, Lord, to anoint each and every sister who is attending this retreat, who is listening to this talk, that they may be inspired, led, and filled by the Spirit to listen to you and understand your will for them, and may be able to live an effective religious life. Bless them, keep them close to you. Mary, our mother, be a mother to us. We ask this in the precious name of Jesus the Lord. Amen. My dear sisters, religious, Pope Francis would say about the religious that I cannot imagine of the church without the religious. When he declared the year of the consecrated, he said this, and then he acknowledged the contribution, the tremendous contribution that the religious congregations, the religious consecrated people have been doing to the church. And now today we are going to reflect upon religious life is a gift and the responsibility. First, I would like to dwell upon religious life as a gift. Yes, it's an unmerited free gift of God. Even Jesus, for him, the vocation that he received is not because of him, because he received it from the Father. So even for Jesus, it was a gift. The vocation that he received to be the priest and a victim is again a gift from his Father. And that's why we read in the letter to the Hebrews, chapter 5, verses 4 to 5. So beautifully, St. Paul, the author of the letter to the Hebrews says, "And one does not presume to take this honor, but takes it only when called by God." Just as Aaron was. Again in verse 5 we read, "So also Christ did not glorify himself in becoming a high priest, but was appointed by the one who said to him, 'You are my son, today I have begotten you.'" So even in the case of Jesus, we know that Jesus accepted as a gift from the Father. That's why Jesus tells us, we read in the Gospel of St. John, chapter 15, verse 16, the first part, "You did not choose me, but I chose you." You did not choose me, but I chose you. It's I who have chosen you. You are mine. So it is Jesus who has called us. It is Jesus who has chosen us. Again, we'll read in Mark's Gospel, chapter 3, verse 13, "He called those whom he wanted." He called those whom he desired. So he wants us. And he calls us. So it is a gift from the Lord. We read in the Bible various vocation narratives. Everyone in the Bible is called by the Lord. It's not of because of their merit, but it is purely out of the love that God had for them. So today I and you are called not because of any of our merits, not because of our talents, not because of our efficiencies, but just because he loves me, he wants me, he desires me. So we need to be convinced of being wanted by the Lord. We need to be convinced of being called by the Lord. We need to be convinced of receiving the gift from the Lord. It's nothing of my merits. It's purely his own free gift. Because he loves me, he gives me. Look at the life of Abraham. Abraham was called by God. Abraham never thought that. Abraham never knew about it. But God chooses Abraham because God wants him. So he calls him. He gives him that gift to belong to God. Again, in the case of Moses, normally speaking, that was the edict of Pharaoh. At the time when Moses was born, every male child of the Hebrews should be put to death. And the midwives were well instructed. But Moses remained alive. Then Moses is brought to the palace of Pharaoh. All this because God wanted Moses. All this because God is giving Moses the gift of life, the gift of vocation, the gift of being belonging to God. And then he shares that vocation to do the work that God himself has to do. Look at Saul, the first king of the Israelites. Did Saul want to be a king? Not at all. He was in fact searching for his lost donkeys. But God picks him up, anoints him a king. Again, none of the merits of Saul. The case of David, a small boy, even his father didn't find him fit to be a king. That's why he kept him in the fields, looking after the sheep. The other sons were kept in the house when Samuel came to anoint one of his sons as a king. So, from the worldly point of view, David was not at all fit, not at all expected to be a king. But God wanted him. Again, it is a gift from God that David receives. No one can say, I will become a priest. No. And no one can say, I will become a religious. You cannot say that. Being in the formation, I have experienced this. There was so nice with all the qualities, sincere, clever, efficient, talented, and so much we had expectations that he would make a very good priest, he will be a great asset to the church, but they didn't become priests. They decided to go back and choose their vocation to a family life. So it is purely the gift of God. Again, we see, so since we know that it is a gift of God, we should be grateful to that gift. The one who does not sufficiently thank God for the gift that he has received, he does not know what vocation is. He does not understand the greatness and the importance of vocation. He does not understand the greatness and importance of religious life. So two ways of responding to the vocation, the religious calling that we have received, is one is to be grateful to it, and another one is to be faithful to it. To be grateful, we need to sufficiently thank God for this wonderful gift of vocation that we have received. Every moment we should be grateful to it. For me, it has become a habit that every day, at the end of the day, when I go to bed, sitting on the bed, I used to look at myself and say, oh, still I am a priest. I am still a priest. What guarantee do I have? I am weak, vulnerable. I can lose it. Anything can happen in my life. But God keeps me in the gift that he has given me, because he wants me, he desires me. So every day when I, before going to bed, I sit on my bed and turn to the Lord and say, Lord, I thank you for still you are keeping me as a priest. We should be able to thank the Lord, because it is such a wonderful gift for which I am not worthy of it. So religious calling, religious life is a gift from the Lord. It's an unmerited free gift of God to each one of us. Also, I would like to see how it is a gift. We can also see within our life. The religious life can be explained through the need theory, which the psychologists use it. The need theory. They explain the human person, the whole life project of the human person, through a need theory, though we don't accept it, but we can explain this need, the life of a religious through the need theory. They would say, for example, a child is born, and then the moment the child is born to this earth, from that moment, different needs are before the child. The whole life of that human person who is born to this earth is fulfilling need after needs. You try to fulfill one need, another need arises. And you fulfill that, another need arises. Till you step into the grave, you have been fulfilling the needs of your life, the various needs of your life. That's how they explain the human life. And we can also take that. A child, as soon as it is born, the first need of the child is to breathe. And that's why it is struggling to breathe, that becomes like a cry. And so the child, the moment the child starts breathing, everything is cleared, smoothly breathing, then the other need arises, that child wants milk, hungry. Then it drinks milk. So when we in the development of the human person, we find the needs keep changing, and the person keeps fulfilling those needs, and then finally when the child grows, becomes an adult, the different needs are coming. Three basic needs come into every human person's life. That is the need for companionship, the need to own or possess things for life, then the need to make one's own decisions. These are the three basic needs of human life. And a person's life is built on these three needs. So a human person experiencing these three basic needs and tries to fulfill that needs, and his whole life is centered around those three needs. For example, a girl, marriageable age, she feels the need for a companion, a life partner, the desire to marry. Either she will find a boy or the home people would find a companion for her. Once that is done, that need is fulfilled, the second need of possessing some things, a house, a job, all the need, other things required for the life. And so in this way, the second need will be fulfilled. Till the end of life, different things are needed for life, and they will be fulfilling it. Then they have to make decisions in life, to make one's own decisions. So in this way, the life is being lived. In our case, when we are in need of a companion, Jesus enters into our life, takes our name, and requests us, Francis, would you like to become my life companion? Would you like to accept me as your life companion? And I say yes, and that's my call, that's my vocation. So Jesus becomes my life companion. I and Jesus together, we start living. And that is the Evangelical Council of Chastity. Since I have Jesus as my life companion, I don't need anyone else. I don't need any other human person to become my life companion, because I have the life companion, Jesus himself. Then the second need, that need to possess things. Jesus is everything for me. And so I don't have to depend on the things of this world. I need to depend on Jesus, who is my life companion, who is everything, who is the creator of the whole universe. So there comes the Evangelical Council of Poverty. Then to make decisions in life, I know Jesus knows all that I need. Jesus knows much more about me than anyone. And so I listen to him. He knows what is best for me. And so I obey him. So the Evangelical Council of Obedience. This is how the life project, the religious life, the religious calling, which is a gift that we have received. And why it is a gift again? It's a gift of Jesus in my life. Because in my life, I am in need of fulfilling. I am in need of fulfilling these three basic needs of my life. And Jesus steps into my life. gives himself as a gift for me, and then fulfills these three needs in a much wonderful, beautiful way, 100%. A human companion will not be that faithful. A human companion will not be 100% loving. But Jesus, who is a gift for me through vocation I have received, he becomes a 100% faithful partner with me. He is my true life companion. That's why in my own life project, when I am in need of the three basic needs, Jesus offers himself as a gift to fulfill my need. And so my vocation to be a religious is a gift from Jesus. And that gift is Jesus himself as my life companion. And that's how we have to look at the religious life. So the religious life really is a tremendous gift. And this gift is the most beautiful thing which can never be compared to anything else. Jesus, the creator of the whole universe, the second person of the Trinity. And in him the Father is present. His spirit will receive such a wonderful gift through our religious calling we receive. And so I must live that life with the Lord, a life of love relationship with him, a life of intimacy with him. That's the essence of my call, to live for Jesus. That's why the little flower would say, not even an atom of my love belongs to anyone else except Jesus. And she would also say, at last I found my vocation at the heart of the church, that is, I will be love. So our call is a call to intimacy. The religious life is a call to intimacy. The religious life is a call to a life of love, a love with Jesus. When I love Jesus as he loves me, that's the command that the Lord gave us. Love one another as I have loved you. When I love Jesus as he loves me, the consequence of loving Jesus as he loves me, I become chaste like Jesus. I become poor like Jesus. I become obedient like Jesus. And that's how the evangelical counsels become my lifestyle. So it is a consequence of loving Jesus as he loves me. So that's why the religious calling is a beautiful gift for us. Now this gift, the religious calling, the religious vocation, this gift has an eternal character. That also we should keep in our mind. It's an eternal character. The book of Jeremiah, chapter 1, verse 4 and 5, the call of Jeremiah. What do we read there? Now the word of the Lord came to me saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations. How beautiful it is. It's not just telling Jeremiah. Today we should be able to hear this being addressed to us. Jesus telling me, before you were formed in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a religious to live and work in the church. That's what the Lord is telling us. Are we aware of it? Today we religious live our life, but we don't realize the greatness of our religious life, the greatness of our vocation, the importance of our vocation, that we cannot sufficiently understand it. So this religious calling is a gift, and so we should sufficiently thank the Lord for this unmerited free gift that the Lord has given to each one of us. Now this gift has its responsibilities. The responsibilities attached to this religious calling, it's a life of total dedication and service, and it is a life of the religious. However, It's a so beautiful, so important, so great occasion, but it is not a bed of roses. Today, in the midst of difficulties and challenges, it seems to be losing ground. Today, in the midst of all the difficulties, challenges, the life of the religious, today it seems to be that religious life is losing ground. Pope Francis said that the contribution of the religious to the church and the world cannot be measured. During the year of Christ, during the year of consecrated life, Pope Francis gave a message for that year. And the message was so beautiful. In short, I can just tell you. First, he said, religious, put Christ at the center of your life. Let your life become Christocentric, Christ-centered. That's the thing that he asked all the consecrated religious. But unfortunately, somehow this was just ignored. After saying this only, Pope Francis said, religious, wake up the world. That slogan was taken up and everywhere it was focused. In all the articles, in all the magazines, in all the seminars, everywhere it was said, Pope is calling in the year of consecrated life to wake up the world. Religious, wake up the world. And how you wake up the world? By being joyful, by being brave, by being people of communion. By being people of communion. So by being joyful, by being brave, by being people of men and women of communion. This is what the message that Pope Francis gave for the year of consecrated life. But this would have been possible only the first thing what Pope Francis said, religious, make your life Christocentric. That's what the gift. Our life is a gift and the gift is Jesus. So that gift has to become sender. It has to become Christocentric. This is what Pope Francis told. At the same time, we have the other side. While majority of the religious live a very committed, holy lives, there are still some living scandalous lives, which affect the church. Scandalous life. These days we hear of religious priests committing suicides. People, ordinary people cannot somehow understand that. Religious priests who are supposed to instill hope in the life of the people, they are committing suicides. There are scandalous lives. Scandals, emotional immaturities, crossing the boundaries and violating the boundaries of sexuality, financial irregularities, conflicts in relationships, lack of collaboration and teamwork. So, this is what we find sometimes now in the life of the religious, and this affects the church so much. So, our responsibility today comes from this. We need to live a life of intimacy with the Lord. I would also like to say, this all scandals, all these things comes up because we have not understood the greatness and the importance of the religious life. The greatest danger in today's religious life is among the consecrated people is that we take things for granted. Taking things for granted. Our religious life, we take it for granted. Our occasion, take it for granted. Our consecrated life, we take it for granted. Another thing I would always say that we cannot, this is another danger. We consider the religious, especially the women religious, we consider them as like any other ordinary women. They are not. They are consecrated people. They are set apart, just like a chalice which cannot be used to drink tea and coffee. It is set apart for the Holy Eucharist. It's set apart for to pour the blood of Jesus. It cannot be used for the other way. So similarly, a consecrated religious is not an ordinary woman. The moment that she makes her profession, the moment she commits herself to Jesus for life, she is consecrated, she is set apart, and she is meant only for Jesus. That Jesus whom she sees in every brother and sister, it is for that Jesus she is meant for. So that's why the set apart. So a consecrated religious should not be looked at as any other woman or a girl, anybody. That's the greatest danger. Also taking life, the consecration, for granted. So we need to understand the greatness of it. And then we have the responsibilities. It is actually a life of complete sharing with Jesus. Every religious has a complete sharing of the life of Jesus. A religious life is a life of intimacy. There are a few points I would like to present before you. The first important sign of this intimacy is complete sharing. So when you have received this gift, the gift of consecrated life, the responsibility follows of total sharing of yourself with Jesus. The first thing, complete sharing. We read St. John's Gospel, chapter 15, verse 15. I do not call you servants any longer, but I call you friends. A servant does not know what the master is doing. I call you friends because all that the Father has revealed to me, I reveal it to you. A total revelation, a total sharing, a complete sharing of Himself with us. You can imagine, Jesus says to us this, I call you friends because all that the Father has revealed to me, I reveal to you. So that's the beauty of our call. So a total sharing, the first thing, do I share everything of mine with the Lord? I get a good news, I get a bad news, who is the first person that I share with? Do I share with my life companion Jesus, who has given Himself as a gift to me? So that is the first sign of intimacy. Second, choice of friendship. John chapter 15 verse 16, the first part, you did not choose me, but I chose you. Jesus has chosen me as His first and best friend. Have I chosen now Jesus as my first and best friend? So I have to choose, choice of friendship. That shows my intimacy. In my life situations, does Jesus becomes my choice? Or sometimes I choose other things, other persons, choose my name, my position? We have to today examine. This is my great responsibility of choosing Jesus. Every time, in every situation, in every incident, in everything, I must choose Jesus as my first and best friend. That's why the little flower could say, not even an atom of my love belongs to anyone else except Jesus. So our life has to become that. So He should be my first and best friend. Thirdly, suffer for the friend. John chapter 15 verse 13 we read, no one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. Lay down one's life for one's friends. So Jesus has laid down His life for me, who is His friend. Am I ready to lay down my life for my Jesus? Am I ready to make sacrifices in my life for my Jesus, who has laid down his life for me because he loves me? He's ready to suffer for me. Am I ready similarly to suffer for Jesus? That's what the life of intimacy. So the responsibility as a gift follows that I must do sacrifice for him because he loves me. The fourth sign of intimacy, not for possessive friendship. John chapter 15 verse 16, the second part. You did not choose me, I chose you, so that you may go and bear fruit, the fruit that endures. He has chosen me so that I may be fruitful. I may go and bear fruit. Not for a possessive friendship. Not to cling on to him, but to do the mission. So the responsibility, the mission becomes my responsibility. The gift that I have received, that is Jesus, now because of that gift, the mission of Jesus becomes my responsibility. I have chosen you to go and bear fruit. Mary Magdalene, after having the apparition of the risen Lord, she wanted to cling on to him. But Jesus says, don't cling to me. Go and tell my brothers. Do the mission. So that is what the intimacy with Jesus. That's my responsibility, the mission. Mission should become my life. Fifth point, friends are of one mind and one heart. John chapter 14 verse 21. John chapter 14 verse 21. I read, those who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me, and those who love me will be loved by my Father, and I will love them and reveal myself to them. See the beauty of it, the love relationship. So friends are of one mind and one heart. As friends of Jesus, as we have received the gift of Jesus, as he has become my life companion, as I have become a consecrated religious for Jesus, I must have the mind and heart of Jesus. Sixth one, concern about the friend. Again we read St. John's Gospel chapter 14 verses 15 to 17. 14, 15 to 17. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. So he is so concerned that he is leaving. So he has asked the Father to give me the Spirit, another advocate, another helper. So the concern that Jesus has for me, do I have the same concern for the Lord? Am I concerned about his glory? Am I concerned about his mission? Am I concerned about his mission? Am I concerned about his church? So I must show that concern in my life. Seventh, the sorrow for separation. Again, John's Gospel chapter 16 verse 16. A little while and you will no longer see me. And again a little while you will see me. So here Jesus is expressing his intimacy with his disciples. He is telling them, I am going to go away from you. He is feeling that sadness, that separation. What separates us from Jesus? Sin separates us from God. So we must have dread for sin. A consecrated religious should have fear of sin, dread for sin, because that's what separates us from Jesus, our life companion. Eighth, happiness in the intimate friendship. John 15 verse 11, we read, I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. He has revealed everything so that I may remain joyful, that your joy may be complete. How beautiful it is. So there is joy in the friendship with Jesus because he is the source of joy who is within me. And the last one, ninth one, a friend wants to be always with the one he loves. That is John 14 verse 23. John 14 verse 23. Jesus answered him, "Those who love me will keep my word, and my Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them." That's the abiding presence. He always remains with us. And that's what Jesus for us is. The intimacy, the responsibilities. Today we should look at ourselves and see, what's our life? Looking at the crisis in the religious life, today it looks to be the consecrated life loses its relevance. Why? Because we are losing our specific identity as a religious, as a consecrated persons. We are trying to become like the others. Yes, we should be one with them, but then our identity should be kept up. Today, the danger today facing the religious life, we cannot accept it as a gift. We are not aware of the responsibilities. It's because the recruitment. Today we are promoting vocations for what? Is it to live a life of intimacy with Jesus, or as a labor force rather than as a vocation? We need personnel to run the institutions, so we search for vocations. We need to correct that today. We have to choose people who are gifted with that gift of Jesus, a life of intimacy, a life of consecration. We have to promote vocations to live the life of Jesus, not to just run institutions, not to work, not for a labor force. Another danger is we have today become a tendency of sticking to our comfort zones. Do not want to take any risk. Do not want to be out with the people facing the difficulties, troubles of life, facing the challenges of life. We want always to be secure, safe, and comfortable. That's what today the religious are looking for. So our basic identity comes from the work that we do, the job that we do, the position that we hold, or our vocation to belong to Jesus. This is what today you have to ask. There is a strong temptation today to relate one's identity to one's functions as an educator, as a social worker, as a professor of philosophy, theology, etc., etc., or scripture, as a counselor, as a doctor, as a lawyer. That's a great danger among us. Also, it is a temptation to relate one's identity to these things. These functions require specializations. But without being a person of moral and spiritual integrity, these are useless. The priority, that's why Pope Francis, while declaring the year of consecrated life, what did he say? Religious, be Christocentric. Put Christ at the center of your life, at the center of your existence. We need to have that. Once we have that, then we would be able to use everything for His glory, for His kingdom, for His mission. Another responsibility in the present day context is that we need to move from the monoculturality to a multicultural relationship, membership, multicultural relationship. We need to move out from our parochial and divisive tendencies. The recognition of other cultures is required today. Respect for cultural diversity and differences. The promotion of a healthy interaction between cultures. Also, inter-congregational collaborations. Collaborative mission with the church, the parish, the diocese. These are required. These are our responsibilities. Then Pope Francis also calls us to move to the peripheries, not to be closed out in the center, not to be in the high compound walls with the securities. Evangelii Gaudium, Pope Francis says, "I prefer a church which is bruised, wounded, hurting, and dirty, because it has been out on the streets." rather than I want a church which is bruised, wounded, dirty, rather than a church which is unhealthy from being confirmed and from clinging to its own security. I do not want a church concerned with being at the center and then ends by being caught up in a web of obsessions and procedures. If something should rightly disturb us and trouble our consciences, it is the fact that so many of our brothers and sisters are living without the support, without the strength, without the light, without the consolation born of friendship with Jesus, without a community of faith to support them, without meaning and goal in life. This is what Pope Francis is saying to us. So today, as we are reflecting about our religious life, which is a gift and a responsibility, it's an unmerited free gift of God. We need to be grateful to Him, thankful to Him, and then we need to be faithful to that call that He has given us. So the responsibility of being intimacy with Jesus. So let us try our best, let's bring a transformation and pray to the Lord that the Lord may really touch you. Let Him give you a fresh anointing of the Spirit so that baptized in the Spirit, soaked in the Spirit, we may become Jesus to all the people. That's what in the essence of a religious calling. So let us pray to the Lord for this grace. Thank you. God bless you.